The two Ġgantija temples sit about 130 meters above sea level on a plateau in the village of Xagħra on Gozo. The complex is a UNESCO World Heritage Site and includes a fantastic interpretation center displaying artifacts excavated from both Ġgantija and the Xagħra stone circle, which is about 500 meters away. Ġgantija lends its name to the phase of Maltese megalithic prehistory, which lasted from 3600 to 3150 BCE, and was when the Neolithic inhabitants of the island started building temples. This was preceded by the Zebrouche phase, during which the people built simple lobed rock-cut tombs, and it was followed by the Safliini and Tarsian phases, which were also characterized by the building of megalithic monuments. Ġgantija isn't the only Neolithic complex in the village of Xagħra. Santa Verna is located about 1 kilometer to the west of it. The site has scanty remains of a single megalithic temple, which was contemporary with Ġgantija. The Xagħra stone circle, which lies about halfway between the two, is a hypogeum dating to the later Tarsian phase. It once had a megalithic stone circle, hence the name, marking its entrance above ground, but little of this remains. Close to Ġgantija, there are a few other scattered megaliths around a cave called the Arta Ezu, in which temple period pottery sherds were found. Even closer to the temples are some megaliths built into a rubble wall, which were likely part of a similar structure in the same complex. In Xagħra, there is also a protected site called Jebla Ta Sansuna, which may be a collapsed dolmen, but could be a natural outcrop. No one is certain about that. Although the Maltese dolmens are thought to be Bronze Age based on the dating of the Ta Hamut set, no thorough excavations have been done around all of them to settle this completely. So if the Jebla Ta Sansuna is a dolmen, its dating would still be somewhat of a question mark. Ġgantija is located by a natural spring caused by a geological fault line. This may have contributed to the choice of location for both practical and ceremonial reasons. The site has two temples which face southeast. The south temple was built first and has five apses, whereas the north temple was built with four apses and a niche. Several excavations have taken place over the years, revealing various structural features, artifacts, and animal remains. One of the most interesting was found under the threshold slab at the entrance to the South Temple. This was a bowl containing a bull's horn, seashells, and pottery sherds. It was probably deposited ritually to bring good luck to the temple or those who stepped into it. Inside one of the apses, a betil or single standing stone was found, which is now in the interpretation center. This was not a part of the structure, it just stood by itself. It's also in this temple that a megalith was found with the carving of a snake. As far as I know, this is the only serpentine carving in any of the Maltese temples. At the back of the temple, there are the remains of a hearth, which still has burn marks on it and was probably used for ritual feasting. The typical tunnel-shaped holes are found throughout both temples, and it's generally thought these were to hold some sort of door screen or barrier made of material which is decomposed. In the north temple, there are also huge holes carved into orthostats on either side of the corridor. They may also have held some sort of screen to block off entrance to that part of the temple. Most of the temples have evidence that corridors, apses, and niches were screened off, as well as raised slabs in the floor at the entrances to different parts of the buildings, or small portal-style windows that need to be climbed through to access a corridor or an apse. These all imply a delineation between the sacred and the profane, a sort of ritualistic procession through the temples. Remnants of red ochre covered building material have also been found, and these have led archaeologists to the conclusion that at least some of Ġgantija's walls were originally plastered and decorated. Red ochre is found throughout the ancient world, in buildings as well as in tombs, and this isn't just limited to the Neolithic period. Red ochre seems to have been used symbolically rather than just for its aesthetic value. As with other temples, stone spheres can be seen lying around. These are generally thought to have been for rolling the megaliths into place. But since they are also found in the hypogeum of House Saflini, which is carved underground to look like a megalithic structure, rather than being made up of huge stone blocks excavated from elsewhere, this explanation seems unlikely to me. Another idea is that they were used as slingshots for hunting. There are no signs of battle or defensive structures in Neolithic Malta, so any kind of weapon is thought to be used for catching birds or other animals. However, the presence of the stone spheres in the hypogeum once again casts doubt on this theory. It seems rather strange that heavy slingshots would be transported in and out of a deep necropolis for the purpose of hunting. Why not just keep them at the nearest temple, the above ground temple? These days, the temples are approached from the interpretation center on slightly higher ground to the northwest. The Nafara hill, where a later Bronze Age settlement was located, can be seen up ahead of the temples. However, old paintings and engravings of the site when it was first discovered show a ramp leading up to the forecourt from the sloping hill to the south, and a trilithon entrance at the end of the ramp built into a megalithic wall. The excavations by the Fraxas project between 2013 and 2018 revealed some megaliths to the south that may have been a part of this structure. These were dated to the Tarshin phase, so they show they were added during a later remodeling of the site. How the temple people originally accessed the complex isn't known. There are also the usual libation holes at Ġgantija, which may or may not have been used for pouring ritual offerings. Apart from the snake carving, there isn't a lot of decoration in the Ġgantija temples, not compared to Tarshin, for example. However, there are pitted blocks, which is a common theme in the Neolithic monuments. This rather curious pitted block seems to have been carved in the center for a specific purpose, but I don't know what. I can't find any information on it. The block acts as a step to the terminal apse of the South Temple, and the carving is funnel-shaped, it's semicircular. Perhaps it was a receptacle for a liquid offering similar to the theory about the libation halls? I don't know. Ġgantija made up a ritual landscape that included several sites on the Xagħra plateau that we've already discussed, as well as other temples located throughout Gozo. Before the church was built at Ġgantija, the priest and antiquarian Emmanuel Magri reported on megalithic remains and many Neolithic finds in that area, although at the time they were commonly thought to be Phoenician. Unfortunately, the remains didn't survive. Also in Gozo, scanty megalithic walls and blocks still exist in other places. The Borjlim Rama temple on the Tachench plateau hasn't been excavated, and a layout can't be determined from what can be seen above ground. However, it's thought to have been a temple or other Neolithic monument. From an aerial view, it looks more like stone circles. It's not easy to find at all, but I put the GPS location on my website. The details are in the description below. In Ain Sealem, there are two megalithic structures close to one another, which also haven't been excavated. The north structure is referred to as the Borj Arib Temple and has two megalithic walls. The south structure is called Limraisbeet and looks like the remains of a stone circle. Both of these sit on private land, but they can be seen from the road. There are also remains of a temple at Tap Marzina in between Victoria and Munshar. I haven't managed to visit these myself, but from what I've read, part of an outer wall and one apse are extant. The overall layout has never been completely determined. So, just as with mainland Malta, it seems ritual activity in Neolithic Gozo was particularly intense and must have supported a fairly large population. There are probably many more temples and hypogea which have yet to be discovered or which didn't survive. Overall, there may have been hundreds of ritual centres on the islands during the Neolithic, which is mystifying. Why didn't the ancient inhabitants invest all their time and resources in just a few important buildings? Was ritual activity such an integral part of everyday life that a small village needed a monumental complex, even though to construct one at that time must have been such a labour-intensive endeavour? There are lots of questions, and I'm going to keep looking for the answers. If you enjoyed that, please like and subscribe. Follow me on Instagram for more content, and go to my website for more details on each of the sites I visit.